hearty welcome to Rene and James, my friends, who are they are real Catholic workers. If you have heard about the Catholic worker, they are the kind that live with the poor and that do so sort of at their own sacrifice. And so I'm especially delighted to have them here. So I'm going to get to their intro in just a minute. In case you're coming and you're wondering, what is the Catholic worker? I thought I would do just a little 5-minute intro on that. So the Catholic worker movement started in 1933. Dorothy Day and Peter Marin were its founders. New York City in the heart of the Great Depression is the setting. Dorothy Day was a young activist, communist sympathizer who had been a journalist and was very active in the social movements of the day, what with the Great Depression and all the economic upheaval. And she had become a Catholic, but was looking for a way of, as a Catholic, putting those passions for the poor into active service in her life. But at that point, it was assumed that if you were a Catholic, you wouldn't have anything to do with radical causes that associated with socialists or communists or that sort of thing. And so she prayed for an answer to how to do this, and she very quickly met this man named Peter Marin. And Peter Marin had a program that he needed someone to put into practice. And the program was hospitality houses. This all done by Catholics. It was a program primarily for the church, primarily for Catholics. What should Catholics do in the midst of the Great Depression, in the midst of wandering hordes of homeless poor in New York City? So he said, we should do 3 things primarily. We should do, each parish should have a hospitality house connected to it where Catholics can serve the poor at a personal sacrifice. So live with the homeless and the poor. We should do roundtable discussions to clarify our minds, getting Catholic social teaching back into our blood, or maybe into it for the first time. And then we should have farming communes to get us back to the land. And that's a whole another story that we probably won't talk a whole lot about tonight. But and so the movement was born. The most popular and well-known part of that 3-prong program is the hospitality houses. Catholic workers are primarily known for their sort of heroic hospitality, and the movement quickly spread all over the country, houses in all the major cities. What else do we want to say about that? Still, the movement continues today. I don't know how many houses exactly there are in the United States today. 80, 100, something like that?
Almost 200.
Is that right? Great. Rene and James now. Rene is one of our own. She's from Eden Prairie. And she has... theology degrees, a master's and a bachelor's from Notre Dame. She'll correct me if I'm getting any of this wrong. She has intermittently lived with and served in various ways the poor, especially in New York City. Most recently, she has lived in Chicago at St. Francis House, and I'm going to let her tell more about that story in just a few minutes. But what else would you want to say? She's a journalist. She writes. So let me let her fill in her own story.
Yeah, I think that's it, basically.
James is from upstate New York originally, and used to teach French, and for a time, and then became a hotshot Wall Street broker of some kind that I don't understand, and made an awful lot of money, and found that dissatisfying, and decided to go and live in a Catholic worker house in Rochester, New York, and was going to go for 1 year. And decided to stay for 9 or something like that. And then moved to the main, the original Catholic worker hospitality house, which Dorothy Day and Peter Marin founded, and that is still running, St. Joseph House in New York, in Manhattan, and stayed there for 3 years. And then most recently serves in a parish that is also a hospitality house in Chicago, the Canterbury House. But I thought, since we're talking about Dorothy Day and Catholic community, it would be worth, you know, Dorothy says, we have all known, this is from her book, The Long Loneliness, we have all known the long loneliness, and we have discovered that the only solution is love, and that love comes with community. Now, when Dorothy says that, she is imagining a particular context that that refers to, and that's the life of St. Joseph House, I imagine, in New York City. So I thought that for the benefit of the rest of us who don't have that kind of on-the-ground social experience, that the first thing to do would be to get both Rene and James to describe for us what community life is like in a hospitality house, so that when we go on and talk about more, in more detail about those things, that we have some idea what they're presupposing as sort of the norm or the baseline. So tell us about, I guess, Rene, tell us about what a day in the life of St. Francis House is like.
Okay. Well, first of all, thanks for having us here, Colin. And we're so excited to be here. I think one other quote that Dorothy Day loved was from Dostoevsky, which is from The Brothers Karamazov. Love in action is a harsh and dreadful thing compared to love in dreams. And I think you feel that once you try to put love in action, as I'm sure all of us feel in different ways in our daily lives. So that came to mind when I was thinking about what a day in the life is like. And I think the biggest thing that living in a Catholic worker house teaches you is to be available. So I love to schedule, like Colin said, I'm a journalist. I love to, you know, sign, you know, overextend myself, you know, have back-to-back-to-back interviews each day, like put way too much on my calendar so I feel productive, the chief virtue of our age, right? Being productive. And there's something really beautiful about having an open day where if you don't have anything scheduled, you'll find if you live at a Catholic worker house or like James at this house that's sort of an open space that tells people you can come here, you can come here if you need anything, that your day will get filled up just sort of walking with people on any adventure. So when I think of like a, so the short answer is there is no typical day. But for us in Chicago, I think a typical day might start, or if I think of like a day that we've had, you know, we would start with morning prayer, and then there's mass at the church. So we do the liturgy of the hours, morning prayer together, go to mass. And then, you know, recently on a Monday or a Tuesday, I found an 18-year-old woman at mass who had a 1-year-old baby, and she kind of, I don't know the full story as you often don't, but she needed somewhere to just rest and get hot food. So I brought her over to the house. She had breakfast. There have been days where I've taken folks from one department of human services to the hospital, back to the house, you know, sat with them as they've called 311, which is how you get a shelter placement in Chicago. And you just sit on the phone for hours and you call back and you call back and you call back. So you just kind of make yourself available to walk with people through whatever crisis that they're going through. And then often there are community dinners at night, right? So Francis House had usually open hospitality hours in the evening where people could come in. We would make a meal twice a week so people could come over and have dinner. And you could find, you know, a bishop, a judge, a Jesuit, and, you know, several people who were living in tents, just all sitting and having conversation together, debating whether Iranians or Irish were better. So, you know, just like you have really surprising and interesting conversations. And people are open to like kind of finding that kinship with people that might not look like that, might not seem like them. So that's one example, but I think James might have a couple stories. Or one story.
Hi, my name is James. Thanks for inviting us. I'm from Rochester, New York, not just upstate New York. but yeah, I lived at, and another thing, the whole Wall Street thing. The way you told the story is the way my dad tells the story. It is not like that at all. But it's, for the purpose of tonight, we'll go with it. But I do not have, I have $168 in my bank account. That's it. That's all I have.
So I told you, these guys are like real Catholic workers. Like,
and I didn't even want a bank account, but I got a paycheck, the first paycheck I'd have in like 8 years that I had to open up at a credit union, not a bank. So, but yeah, so I'm going to talk about St. Joe's in New York because it's a little bit, yeah, every house is different. It responds differently to the neighborhood that it's in, to what the problems are seeing. And, you know, many houses of hospitality in the United States deal with homelessness, people experiencing homelessness, drug addiction, mental health issues. And New York City, St. Joe's house was no different. It was a five-story brick building. On the first floor was the soup kitchen. And every day, every day of the week, there was a meal put out in the morning. And then the four floors above it, Catholic workers like myself and people who had been invited in by Catholic workers from many years ago were living there. And so some people had lived there for 20 years. You walk into their house, and I think there's this, you know, living with people who are ex-cons, who are who had been homeless for many years. You know, really, you really are living in a very interesting environment, to say the least. And I think you're not making money on top of it. In New York, we made $20 a week. They called it ice cream money because you could really only afford ice cream. And that's what, that was Dorothy Day who came up with ice cream money. You're living with and you're for the people that you're with. I think one thing a Catholic worker does very well is teach people how little you need to live. That you really just need food, clothing, you know, the corporal works of mercy, basically, and nothing beyond that. And, there are many stories, I could tell you many personalities, but you're really in touch with reality. It's not like Pope Francis talks about the living in the unreality where we don't see the person, the beggar in the street, but in a Catholic worker, you're just confronted with reality and you can't avoid it. The sense of community that comes around, it's incredible to me to think that like I live in community with people who are ex-cons, who are formerly homeless, and these are my friends, my close friends. There's a very deep sense of community, and you can find it very easily among people who are on the margins and who have no place to lay their hat, really.
That's good. So, it's probably worth saying that for many Catholic worker houses, the ideal is somebody. I don't know if it's an ideal, but the hope is that there will be many people who sort of come from the street and stay for a long time. You're not necessarily looking for a lot of turnover. You're not necessarily looking to help people get back on their feet. If that happens, then great. But one of the primary things that you're looking for is community itself, a community that exists between all those different kinds of people that James just named, so that you do get to have friendships with the folks that you're with. It's not primarily an operation of helping people, although it is that, a sort of one-way helping people, but it's a mutual helping in a particular way. Is that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, I feel as though I receive just as much from, I get something that I can't even describe it, but a joy. And sometimes hanging around people who are homeless, or they just call it how it is, and they really understand God. Like, they know God. There's no 401k that they depend on. There's no savings account. They depend on God. When you give them something, I've always noticed this, they thank God first, and then they thank you. Like, yeah. Oh, thank God, I needed this. Thanks so much. And,
sure.
You know, so it really helps. It teaches me seek the kingdom of God first, right? And I don't know if that answers it, but.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to add just a story. Like, when James was saying, like, they really know God, there's a Bible study on Tuesday nights that James hosts after the soup kitchen at the parish. That was Aaron's idea, one of our friends who goes to soup kitchen. And just like, it's phenomenal. Like, I feel like I've got 2 theology degrees, and this is like some of the most interesting conversations I've ever had about the scripture in these Tuesday night Bible studies. And our friend Michelle said, what did she say? We were reading the gospel for this upcoming Sunday, and she just said, we were talking about the beloved son, and she's just like, it's so hard to accept that God loves us. And like, it's so real, like God, we are God's beloved sons and daughters. And like, wow, that's so hard to accept, you know, but how amazing is that? And I was like, wow, that's the best theology I've heard all day.
Right. So when I was talking to Rene, I think I broached the topic of them coming up to do tonight many months ago, and I was sort of talking about wanting to have a session on Dorothy Day and Christian community, and she said, you know, that's funny because the Catholic worker is known primarily for engaging with poverty and with the homeless and things like that, but by far and away, most of our conversations these days, the most prevalent topic that we throw around the table is community. Why do you think that is? What made you say that?
Yeah, I think at least with people my age, I'm a millennial, a mid-millennial. I think we talk about it because we're searching for it and we don't have it. I think we're kind of feeling this crisis of community and belonging in the ways that a lot of our parents, maybe, and grandparents found belonging. Like, those aren't avenues necessarily available for us. And one of the first quote on the handout is this snippet from an investigation the Associated Press did several years ago in 2020 into palm oil. And palm oil is something that's in most products that you'll get off the store shelves. And it's looking into all the abuses and, you know, the awful worker exploitation that takes place in that industry, which, like, obviously, if we know Catholic social teaching, you think, okay, well, that's not respecting human dignity or the dignity of work. It's not promoting the common good. Like, there's nothing about subsidiarity and solid. If we're trying to live out these principles, like, every time I buy, you know, a product that has that palm oil in it off the shelf, I'm most likely participating in a system of exploitation, which is not what we're called to as Christians. Like, we're called to love our neighbor and for our social realities to reflect that love and care for our neighbor who is made of the image and likeness of God. So I think so many of us kind of feel, even if that's a very particular example, but I feel like it's a great image of the world in which we're living, where I think me and many of my generation and, you know, younger teens and 20-year-olds as well are aware that we're living in a world of exploitation where we're kind of participating in isolation or evil without knowing how to stop it and not necessarily being responsible for it. And so I think we talk about community because we're living in a world designed for isolation, and it's designed for isolation and exploitation. And I think one of the things we talk about, especially among my Catholic friends, is just how our concept of vocation, or the way we're taught vocation or taught sanctity, there's a level we're sort of coming to realize of like, oh, this means operating against the grain of our culture, right? Or against the grain for maybe how the world is designed to work. You may have to, you're going to have to try something different than often the path that's laid out for you in a nice college like Notre Dame, where you go to and you're taught how to succeed. And you're like, well, maybe actually becoming a saint means different than this path forward of material success. I think a lot of, I just read Tolstoy, kind of had this conversion in his 50s, the author Leo Tolstoy, and he'd written War and Peace and Anna Karenina and all these amazing books. And he kind of had this moment where he said, I'm just, like, I feel like my life is worthless and meaningless. And one thing he said that I think summed up what so many of my peers feel as we search for community is that he said, I had no other goal except self-perfection and no standard for self-perfection except being better than other people and being thought of highly by them. And so I just think we talk about community because we see so many signs that community is not happening. We see tents on our streets. We see mental illness, you know, among our neighbors on the streets, but also in our own homes, right? And among friends and loved ones that we don't know how to help. And we see that sort of despair. So I think that's why we find ourselves talking about community a lot. Do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think I'm not as an eloquent speaker as Rene is. But I think one thing that I see a lot of is, yeah, we are taught in, you know, if we're cradle Catholics or convert, you know, if we're Catholic or if we're Christian, you know, we're taught these great things. We read the Acts of the Apostles, this communal nature of the sacraments, the Eucharist, very communal, communal action. But it seems to like disappear after high school, you know, and then you go out into college, you know, you go to college or you get a job. And like there's really just a lack of Catholic community for people to tap into. At least there was for me. I started at a Jesuit college. I feel like what I got at college was not how to be a good Catholic, but how to be a good businessman, how to be a good capitalist. And that requires a lot of individualism, that rugged individualism where, you know, you really have to, you know, Wall Street, like you literally have to step on people to succeed, or you really have to turn off, tone down that moral or ethical sense. And so we don't live by the ethics and morals of the Gospels or the encyclicals. We live by the ethics and morals, at least I did, not to make it about everyone, but by the ethics and morals of business, of the secular world. And that does not promote community, in my experience.
So I think you pointed out a couple of different ways that what our world encourages us to do, if we're not intentionally trying to get back to the gospel and live it out, there are lots of ways that in fact our world fragments us and separates us. And one of the major ways is that we're not so much encouraged to be bound together with our neighbors, as the way things go is that we have to always be trying to be better than our neighbors in some ways. It also, you know, it strikes me that last week we talked about those sort of internal goods of communities, those practices that that are the common glue that binds them together, things that they do, things that we do together that fuse us together and make us sort of centripetal force, much like some of the communities that have even existed in the last 100 years or so right here in St. Paul. Even if they weren't perfect, you know, they were ethnic Italian, Irish, and German communities, all that had a bunch of common practices, you know, small businesses, cooperatives of various kinds that bound them together. But what comes, I think, to take its place so much of the time is our consumerist culture, right? And what happens when a local community gets surrounded by a culture of consumerism, but that everybody, instead of looking inwards towards the common good, starts to look external towards where can I get the thing that I want? And so that internal pull, where you're bound up with other people so that your good is their good, gets flipped around the other way. So we're all always looking for how I can best maximize my own potential, best fulfill my own desires, rather than looking internally towards how can we best, what's best for the community. So anyways, that's just a little bit of gloss on what I heard you guys saying. So let's turn to the next point. What are some ways of thinking about, this is the thinking big point, what are some ways that Dorothy and Peter help us to think about, think sort of theologically about how to remedy this situation?
Yeah, I think just what you were saying, Colin, reminds me of, for Dorothy, like the mystical body of Christ was so central. Like if you read The Long Loneliness, and she also talks about it from Union Square to Rome and Houses of Hospitality, she speaks about she was writing about this farmer's delegation. I think it was the farmer's delegation. There was the Hunger March. Yeah, the farmer's delegation in Washington. You can go to Commonweal's website, I think, and read she wrote about it for Commonweal, for a Catholic magazine. And she was so struck by these working men and the poor and just thinking, these are Christ's poor. And where are the Catholics, right, who are like, Christ is so close to them, he's among them. Where are the Catholics who are among them, right? We should be there ministering to them, like listening to their demands for a more just world. And so her image really of the mystical body of Christ and of the unity and the common brotherhood of man, which are kind of maybe more secular terms for that mystical body of Christ, really, really drives so much of her vision for the transformation of the social order. And so after she attended that march, she prayed in the Basilica of the Immaculate Conception, right on the eve of the feast day, who is the national, Mary the Immaculate Conception is the patron of the Americas. And she really prayed for guidance. And she said, you know, if I hadn't prayed for that prayer that Christ would show me a way to use my Catholic faith, you know, to minister to the poor, I don't know that I would have listened to Peter. Like Peter showed up at her apartment a day later, something like that. And, you know, He was an odd duck, right? He was a brilliant, brilliant man, right? He was a great reader. He introduced her to so many Catholic philosophers, But yeah, she's like, if I hadn't said that prayer, I don't know that I would have, she's like, I would have listened and gone my own way and continued just writing my articles, right? Like, it kind of was this beautiful providential timing. And so she writes, you know, Peter has this program. Peter's program is the three C's, as it's often called: cult, culture, and cultivation. So the idea that worship of God or cult is at the heart of everything. And culture, often in Catholic worker spaces, we talk about that as clarification of thought. So the movement starts with a newspaper, right? It starts to disseminate ideas. It starts to try to help educate working class readers who might be in Union Square picking up a copy of the Communist Daily Worker saying, here's a Catholic alternative, which has encyclicals, right? It has sort of like this elucidation of a Catholic understanding of how to engage with the world. And that really is ultimately, talk about thinking big, right? That's the goal of the worker, is to say the gospel is our sort of theory of change, right? We actually, you know, often I feel like the way we operate is we bring the gospel into whatever culture we're in. And, you know, we can debate that for hours. But like, what the worker is saying is, actually, let's start with the gospel. Like, we're gonna try to build a gospel on, build a culture off the gospel. And so one of our favorite Catholic worker editorials is from 1940. And it's in their aims and purposes. And it's on that handout as well, where Dorothy says, you know, she puts it very simply, the vision is this: we're working for a new heaven and a new earth wherein justice dwelleth. You know, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So really connecting it to that, to the text of the Our Father. And what I love about this so much, which I think is why it fits for like the thinking big, is she talks about, she starts with this mystical body of Christ, and then she brings it into applications that might not be apparent to, you know, I was a theater and theology major. I wasn't thinking about economic structures for most of my life, right? But she really connects it with these day-to-day, very mundane institutions that drive so much of how we order our own lives and how we interact with others. So she talks about the racial question, unions, right? So workers' unions, cooperatives, credit unions, crafts, instead of, you know, getting machine-made goods, right? Sort of that manual labor. And I love that for her, those really are, that mystical body of Christ is really informing any idea she has of how to go about a new economic way or like a reconstructed social order. It begins with this idea of the mystical body of Christ. Like, we are all members of one another. We're all parts of Christ's body.
So the big picture.
Big picture.
Well, to play off what Rene was just saying, and the quote talking about cooperatives, credit unions, community land trusts is another thing that Dorothy Day and Peter Moore talked a lot about. But yeah, in order to do these types of things, cooperatives that are, you know, my Irish ancestors at church had cooperatives, and in New York City before we moved to Rochester. But yeah, we need to form cooperators first, and it's individualists or rugged individuals cannot form cooperatives, and I think the church could play a very large role in forming cooperatives or cooperators. And I think it's, you know, it's right theologically, it's in there. You know, we cooperate with God in the Eucharist, in the liturgy. We cooperate with, we make the elements, the bread and the wine made by human hands. We proceed together as, you know, it's a procession. It's not a line. You know, like, we're going to receive, you know, we're going to check out line at the grocery store. This is, you know, proceeding toward Christ. And it's, you know, it's supposed to be a visible example of our pilgrim church. And, you know, I guess what I think of is how, after Mass, yeah, how do we continue this procession out? How do we bring Christ out into the world? And again, how do we create institutions and things that can that are for the common good, that are made by human hands, still, again, made by human hands. And So I think that's something that there's a great example. Do you mind if I jump into?
Sure. Great. There's
a great example of someone, a Catholic priest by the name of Father Jose Maria Arizmendi. And he is he's known as the father of the Mondragon worker-owned cooperative in the Basque region of Spain. And Mondragon is the large, like if you talk about worker-owned cooperatives, Mondragon is the gold standard. If you were to Google worker-owned cooperatives, probably the first five results would be Mondragon. And it was started by this Catholic priest who was a contemporary of Dorothy Day and Peter Morin, and they read the same encyclicals. They were reading the same French Catholic philosophers, Jacques Maritain and Mounier. And the story, oftentimes, when the story is told of the history of Mondragon, they'll say in 1956, six people started Mondragon because in 1942, they started a technical school. And everyone became technically smart and were able to start an engineering firm in 1956. But the reality is that, you know, Father Jose Arizmendi came after 10 years of preparation of minor and major seminary, being indoctrinated in the encyclicals, in this idea of reconstructing the social order, and filled with these ideas of cooperatives, and he took all these little, he created these little institutions. One was Catholic Action, which was kind of like a youth group, but he made them democratically controlled. He made the people, the students run these organizations. The school that he started was democratically run as well. And so for 12 years, they did roundtable discussions, same thing that the Catholic Worker, Clarity of Thought. They were talking about French Catholic philosophers. They were talking about French politics. They were talking about distributionists. You know, so like he formed them for 12 years before a cooperative started, and I think that's, you know, we need to kind of take a look at this model and this and the life and work of priests, and also realize that the Catholic Worker movement has this tradition also infused in its philosophy. So I did bring a couple of articles. There's like 15 copies in the back, but there's an article on Jose Arizmendi, on his, there's a biography, and then there's a New Yorker article that came out a few years ago. He's on his way to sainthood. He's a servant of God. He died in 1976 on the same day that Dorothy Day died. And he died November 29th. 1976, Dorothy Day died on November 29th, 1980. I hope they're canonized together.
Are you going to say something, Rene? Yep. So maybe what we've got is we've got an example here of three different sort of levels. We've got the Eucharist, which is sort of our center and which gives us, in a lot of ways, the logic of the Christian life, right? The Eucharist should be, and Dorothy talked about this too, the logic of the Eucharist should be what extends out into the rest of our life to become the logic of our life. And then the second level is you've got Catholic Worker hospitality houses that try to embody that in a very practical way. And then this third level is what James was just talking about, getting that down into the nitty-gritty of economic life and daily toil and the way that we organize society. And I wonder if it would be useful to talk about three different principles of Catholic social teaching, and then our three principles that are especially near and dear to the heart. I'm making this up as I go, by the way, so we haven't talked about doing this. That are especially close to the Catholic Worker. Personalism, subsidiarity, and solidarity. Because it seems to me that the Catholic worker vision, and it's just taking the Catholic worker vision is just taking this from Catholic social teaching, is radically different from what you would get oftentimes in the secular world, especially in those latter two models. So do you guys want to talk just briefly about at least those latter two?
Well, because I think this is kind of what you're getting at, but I was going to say, like, Mondragon is a very inspiring example, but we've kind of all been talking about how one thing you find once you begin to form communities is how quickly communities become institutions, which become bureaucracies. So you're kind of getting at. So really the goal is not for everyone to go out and form over 500,000 worker-owned cooperative, right? That's amazing. And that's like incredible fruit of something that started very small as five people sitting for 12 years, right? Like being formed by this priest. And so do you want us to share some examples of what you can do for 12 years to form yourself?
Yeah,
things
sure.
That might form you into like how to foster this kind of community. So, I mean, I can start with a very easy, like low-hanging fruit example, which is prayer. but I know some people who started, Teresa did communal prayer in New York, like at 7 a.m., so I never went. But like that sort of doing communal prayer has really just been so grounding. And like I stole my mom's Liturgy of the Hour books when I was like 16 or something. I have no idea why, but I've been praying it on my own for a long time, and I have found myself so transformed by the practice of praying it in community. And I do think there's something, obviously all liturgies, right? Liturgy of the Hours, the Liturgy of the Mass, these are all public prayers. And it has been very transforming for me to pray the hours in community. It's completely changed the way that I see that prayer. So I feel like that prayer is something that Dorothy Day and Peter Morin were very revolutionary in the beginning. They worked with Virgil Michael, who was a Benedictine here at St. John's, right?
And at Assumption.
What?
Yeah. Get out of here.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Oh my gosh. Well, this feels really special to be here now.
Yeah.
I mean, it was special before, but it's really special.
You're doing a good job. Don't say
that. Okay, yeah, that's very cool. So he was a very important person to Dorothy and Peter. And like, there's a great story where, you know, Dorothy and Peter began saying Compline at the Catholic Worker in the early days, and people were like, what is this? This is for monks, we're lay people, we should be praying the rosary. You know, there was a lot of resistance to praying night prayer. Absolutely. That is pretty cool.
I was just thinking of Solidarity, which is another one that you mentioned. And so, two seminarians were just came in here to say hello. They came to Chicago. They stayed with me for 3 weeks. They were doing a poverty immersion. And so one of the things that I did, I think I wasn't sure what the total plan or idea that the diocese or the seminaries had in mind. But I was like, okay, poverty immersion, so you should be poor. And, what I asked them to do was to leave the house in the morning. And I gave them a list of different food, you know, soup kitchens and things like that. And go out and be, you know, walk to where you have to go. When you're homeless, you're very migratory. It's a very migratory existence. You're going from one food source to another, to a soup kitchen, to a warm place.
What time were they allowed to come back?
They could come back after the soup kitchen at St. Thomas of Canterbury. And so, yeah, they spent the whole day. And I encouraged them really to talk to people. And I told them, don't tell anyone you're a seminarian because they'll give you everything you want if you walk into a church. But, yeah, I think that, like, we can all, it's a very easy thing to do. And I think people are like, oh, I don't want to take food out of someone's mouth, or I don't want to. And if this whole room went and did it tomorrow, yeah, maybe that would be a problem. But I think a good Lenten practice, like, take a Saturday and spend the day in solidarity with people who are experiencing homelessness. And, go to the library or walk between soup kitchens. I had another challenge, like get a whole outfit, go to a clothing closet and swap out, donate clothes and get another. And it seems very pointless in a way, but I think it informs you It gives you, a deeper sense of solidarity, I think. And then the solidarity of just getting to know people. And, voluntary poverty for me, I think makes that easier when you're working with people who are homeless or on the margins. It also challenges people who are rich. You know, like my family and friends, they think I'm super poor, but the people I work with think I'm rich. And, but getting to know people and the personalism, getting personally involved and trying to walk with people. You don't have to solve every problem, but being present, I think is huge. And the crisis, no one's going to starve to death in Minneapolis or Chicago. Or the crisis, in my mind, is a crisis of loneliness, a crisis of having no one to talk to. And I feel like really that's what we do, is we just listen. And it's exhausting. And, I feel sometimes like, okay, this is maybe how a priest feels if they were listening to the confession all day. And because that's really what you're getting, is it's very heavy. You really do need to pray if you're going to be doing it.
One thing, just to piggyback off of what James was saying, I also am very good. We all love, right? Like being a helper. It's very hard to receive help. And so one thing we've also done is the parish has a soup kitchen. They have so many volunteers who are wonderful, but they don't need any more volunteers. So we just go and sit. And I think it's challenging, right? To see, like, I think we're very comfortable with this division between the helper and the helped. And to put yourself in the position of the helped is really transformative, right? Because it's uncomfortable and you're like, oh, well, like, I don't actually need your help. I'm just here for like formation or whatever. But to say like, oh, actually I do need, think of all the people who've helped us, or to be a human is to have received life. You didn't make it yourself, right? You kind of come into this world needing help. I think one other example, this was like, do you want to talk about the two first nights of the begging pilgrimage? This was us putting the asking for help, solidarity.
I'll tell the first night.
Okay.
You tell the second.
Okay.
All right, so we did a walking pilgrimage across lovely New York State. We started in the Finger Lakes region. It was about 114 miles, and the idea was we were going to beg along the way and go to Catholic churches and ask for hospitality. And our first night, we go to the Catholic church. We're on pilgrimage. We're Catholic workers. And as soon as you heard Catholic workers, like, oh, gosh, like Dorothy Day. Oh, jeez, what am I going to do here? And he's like, I can't put you up in my church. It's, liability. And which, I'd been around the Catholic church long enough to know that that would probably be the answer. But we asked him for blankets. He had no blankets. And then finally, I was starting to feel bad. I was like, can you give us a blessing or something? He's like, I'm giving you a blessing. He didn't know as if he knew any of the Protestant clergy in town. He's like, I don't know them. And I was like, wow, okay. So we ended up sleeping in a gazebo in Watkins Glen, New York, which is where a very famous NASCAR race happens, too. It wasn't going on that night. Very stark, very different story the next night.
Yeah, sleeping is maybe too strong a word. I think I might have slept an hour and James didn't get any sleep. But the next day, so we didn't have any sleep. We go to church, we go to church with the same priest who turned us away and, go to Mass, receive communion. James catnaps in the back of church. And we cheated a little bit and took a bus part of the way to save because we were tired. And then we walked the rest of the way, and we had tried to call friends. We were like, hey, maybe we'll like call ahead and see if we can like, clearly that did not work. Just showing up and saying, we're Catholic workers, we need hospitality, help us. We're like, we should, you know, have someone call ahead and recommend us, and nothing worked out. So we just kept walking. We're like, we'll see how this works. The church we arrived at was called St. James, and it had the two pilgrim shells on the door, so a pretty good sign. And we knew it was run by Franciscans, but we thought it looked like, you know, it was a merged parish, and we were like, huh, maybe the Franciscans actually don't live here, so no one might be around. We walked over to the rectory, and we knocked on the door, and these two old ladies come to the door, and they're like, hello? And we're like, hello? And, you know, they said, you know, who are you? And we're like, well, we're two Catholic workers. We were on pilgrimage to Syracuse to the shrine of St. Mary Ann Cope. And so we said that. And they're like, look, you know, we're begging for hospitality. Like, can we sleep in the church? And they kind of looked at each other and they looked at us and they said, okay, well, like, I think they're like, well, let's talk and like see what we can do. And they were of the same order that had taught James in elementary school in Rochester. So they started, you know, getting to know him, like swapping some names. You know, we were chatting and they said, you know, look, like we just have one, you know, one guest bed in the guest bedroom, but like, you know, if you want to see what we have, like, come on in. And we just had this really beautiful evening. James ended up sleeping in the basement and we had shared a lovely meal and we just sat and talked, and it was such a beautiful gift. And it's an encounter that reminds me so much of what the quote Colin quoted from Dorothy Day, right? We've all known the long loneliness, and the solution is love, and that love comes with community. And that them opening those doors and welcoming us in was such a, you know, they said that we were talking the next morning about what a surprise it was, right? For both of us, it was a, you know, Sister Anne said that she had been praying, you know, that morning she had been praying, this was in 2022, so maybe 3 months into the Ukraine war, and she had been praying to do something to help, you know, refugees in Ukraine. And then she said, we walked up to the door like later that day and she's like, well, here are people asking for help, you know, how can I turn them away? And just it was such a beautiful example of the gift of relationship we received by asking for something, by kind of showing up and putting ourselves in the place of the beggar. And the gift of relationship they received by surprising themselves and opening the door to the unexpected stranger.
I'm struck by, and this is an example, right, of community being formed, not by helping somebody, but by being helped.
Okay, I'm gonna try to cheat and answer multiple questions at once. I know. Okay. So there are two that I, there are some that are easy to answer. So do voluntary Catholic workers make a vow of poverty, sell all they have, give it to the poor, and live in hospitality houses? Or actually, you should answer that one, so I'm gonna leave that. Because everyone, the answer is no, there is no vow. But the way people strip themselves of what you have is always very interesting and slow. And I think I have too much stuff now. Like, you just start to accumulate things. So, so someone asked, what is an attachment do you think is most an obstacle for Catholics who want to live in genuine community? And there are two things that immediately spring to mind. Obviously, like, attachment is very subjective, all that stuff. But one, I think, is delivery apps, so food delivery apps, and the second is credit cards. And when I started committing to voluntary poverty before I started living in a Catholic worker house. And I was a freelance journalist paying New York rent. So it was quite the adventure, right, to say, okay, I'm committed to doing this. And I honestly, to this day, don't know how I was able to make rent. My parents helped me out with 1 month. But other than that, I have no idea how it happened. But at the time, I started getting rid of all of my credit cards because I just realized that credit is a good thing, right? And this is not financial advice. But I just realized that they were preventing me from really encountering my own limitations and my own poverty. And that if I if I didn't have them, I would actually have to be forced to reckon with the fact that I needed to ask for help and I needed to do things like go to a food pantry, which is embarrassing, and was for me at the time at least. And, you know, to ask for groceries from the Catholic worker, to rely on others. And so credit cards are a great way for me to feel like I don't need to rely on others. So that's kind of the underlying obstacle, right? That fear of relying on others, because it's scary. And it can go poorly for you, right? And so it is a real risk. And the second thing with the food delivery apps is that I think there are so many ways that we're distanced from others, and it's becoming so easy and so frictionless to just treat others like a non-entity, to see a button, to see a screen. Even just calling up the pizza place or the Chinese restaurant and ordering takeout, right? That's an action that's going to so much more foster real community than to interact with something so impersonal. So I think there are small ways in which we're having these sorts of small personal interactions or these ways of acknowledging others' humanity being taken away. So those are my two answers.
I'm trying to see a pattern here. But there's one question that pops out to me. If many who are homeless and poor suffer from mental illness or addiction, why not try to help them by connecting them with experts who are educated to address these issues? Community alone doesn't address these root causes. And yeah, I mean, definitely if people come in with addiction issues pretty much everyone who walks through the door has some sort of issue, whether it be addiction or mental health. And of course, yeah, always offering whatever they want. I'm not going to tell someone exactly what they should do with their lives, but hey, here's what's available. And if you want it, you know where to find me. But I do think that addiction and mental health and community are very related. And I don't have a study or anything to back that up. But I just living in and seeing how we respond to all these different issues, there is a community, the Rochester Catholic worker had a soup kitchen that supported a soup kitchen in Haiti, and I was able to go visit it because I speak French. So like, yeah, okay, now we got a French person, send James over. And so I went there, and I was in Port-au-Prince. I was in a very much the northwest. It was at a place called Oboy. But 90% unemployment, no running water, no electricity. And all I saw was joy. The churches were full. I saw no homeless people. There was one town drunk and one woman who was mentally ill. But they took care of these people. Everyone had a place to stay. And when I was going to Haiti, I was in a really bad spot. I'd been running a shelter in Rochester. It really burns you out running a shelter. And I was like, my gosh, I'm going to this really poor country. And when I left Haiti and was coming back to the United States, I was really bummed because I was like, I'm coming back. We call Haiti the third world. And it kind of dawned on me, like, I live in the third world spiritual country of the United States. We are third world spiritually. We're first world in every other sense.
It also seems to me on that I think that's a great question. And of course, everybody who comes in, if they say, I'd like to get help for X, Y, or Z, sure, you point them in that direction. Or you do what you can. But also, if the cause of these maladies that we have in our society, such that the people walking through the door do have these issues, is a breakup of community, such that the community in Haiti didn't have so many of these issues precisely because they were a more fulsome community, then what we don't want to do is take everyone and funnel them into a bureaucracy that has been created to deal with each of them individually and keep them separate, as it often does, from the community by making them part of these external systems that are their own communities. What we want to always be holding out to folks is that personalism, that you belong here. You don't first belong to whatever system is going to take care of whatever problem you have. You first belong here. And sure, if you want to, we can tap into some of this other stuff. But this is primarily a place where you can be.
Mm. And anyway, to jump in with a study to support those two points, Bessel van der Kolk is one of the leading sort of PTSD experts who wrote The Body Keeps the Score, which came out 10 years ago. And he talks a lot about his trauma research. He was working studying PTSD right when this was sort of becoming a diagnosis during the Vietnam War and afterwards. And there's one study he cites. It was very interesting reading after having lived for a while in a Catholic worker house and among people who are traumatized, right? Like, even being homeless for a night is traumatizing, right? Even having this sense of the social fabric failing you for one night is awful, right? It's dehumanizing. And so much of what he was saying about trauma, there's one study where he talks about dogs. This is, you know, awful. But so there are dogs that were being kept in kennels and electrocuted on a grid. And once, this was like in Germany or something, and the kennel door is open so the dog can technically escape, but they won't, right? They're just going to cower in the corner because they're so traumatized from this shock and this uncomfortable, unsafe environment that they'll just keep cowering in the corner even if the kennel door is open and they can run away, unless they're shown the way out, right? Unless you sort of walk with them and show them how to get out of the kennel, they won't leave. And I think, you know, we probably all have examples in our own life of people who are stuck in traumatic and unhealthy circumstances, or we have been ourselves. And I look at so many of our friends on the street and I think the same thing, right? It takes so long to show someone the way out of a very painful, traumatic situation. And so much of what he says in The Body Keeps the Score also comes down to just knowing someone's name and knowing who they are. We have a friend, Jonathan, who lives in New York, and he's very tall and very, you know, he's often talking to things that aren't there, and he can be very aggressive and he looks scary. But the moment you say, "Hey, Jonathan, like, how's it going?" He's just like, "Oh, hey." You know, like, knowing, you know, like, there's a reason we have that, like, scripture verse, like, "You are called by name, like, I've called you by name, you are mine," right? That is a great way of, like, That is very essential to helping people overcome the underlying trauma that often is manifest in other mental illness symptoms or addiction. So there's a little study. Do you want to answer another question?
You think we have time for another?
Oh, yeah.
I just chose this one.
Yeah.
Is there a priest or order that supports Catholic worker efforts? No, not officially. The Catholic Worker is not official, not an official association of the Catholic Church. It's not. It never sought it, and every community is different. There's no president of the Catholic Worker movement. There's no governing. There's no voting. There's no the best I can tell, the least, the criteria to call yourself a Catholic worker, and we can all do this, so we can all call ourselves Catholic workers, as best I can see, or some old timer told me, it was like, you have to do at least one work of mercy to call yourself a Catholic worker. And, but officially, no, but many priests do support Catholic worker houses. They say mass there sometimes. It depends on the relationship and the flavor of Catholic worker house that's going on there. Some Catholic workers, very, very faithful Catholics, and really want to do that synthesis that Peter Moran was talking about, that cult, culture, cultivation, kind of synthesizing these three things. And I think the better, the closer a house is to a parish, the better it is, because if in the Joy of the Gospel by Pope Francis, like a document I love, he talks about the danger of not being part of a parish. And I've seen that it can happen in not only Catholic workers, but in anything where you just meet all the time yourselves, and you lose that parish connection, and you become your own parish without a priest, without sacraments, with nothing. And so officially no, but many priests do interact, and yeah, I think they need to be invited in though. I think that's the big key.
I feel like there's a couple of questions kind of about relationships between Catholic workers and parishes. So do you want to maybe talk about Canterbury House?
Sure. So Canterbury House is where it's. So I live in Chicago, and Canterbury House is an old rectory next to St. Thomas of Canterbury Church, which runs a soup kitchen and a food pantry already. And it's kind of like, yeah, an attempt to make, to create a Catholic worker attached to a parish, even though it's not called a Catholic worker. Yeah, hospitality is going on there. A refugee family is living there now. There's four kids and a mom and dad. I live there. There's another another person living there. Just roundtable discussions. Bible study. The Bible study is great. It's. Where it was this very empty space is now reaching out to the neighborhood. And, neighbors, I've had dinner with neighbors. We've worked together on issues in the neighborhood. I think for a lot of people, it's the first time they've interacted with Catholics or the Catholic Church. And I think they really walk away with a very positive experience. And, I'm very careful, especially in dealing with my neighbors. Because I know, I know how we're portrayed and the sentiment out in society right now, just on religion in general. So, but I think, Catholic social teaching is a great language to speak with our neighbors. And there's a garden. We started Solidarity Gardens where we feed, we grow food for the food pantry and the soup kitchen and ourselves.
In a parking lot. He started a community garden in a parking lot.
Yeah, in the parking lot across the street from the church. And there's a network. Students from Loyola University are involved. Neighbors are involved. You have a garden in a parking lot. People walk by and they're like, what's going on here? And, it's really, I think... the Venezuelans and that have moved in, they're all going through RCIA, and all their kids are getting baptized. And there's like 16 confirmations and first communions and baptisms that are going to be going on in June. And so it's like this house that was empty in 2022 has, I think has like. Really reached out to the neighborhood and has done hospitality not only for the people experiencing homelessness but for the responding to the refugee crisis that is just massive in Chicago. We've had 35,000 people come in since last September, and this family has just revitalized. The house was so big and cavernous and quiet, now it's like a herd of elephants upstairs. So yeah, I think it's a model. It's something that Catholic worker, I don't think I had I not lived in Catholic Worker House of Hospitality, there's just no way I would have been able to come up with this stuff on my own or respond in the way. Because I think at a Catholic Worker, you don't make programs. The people come to you, you bear witness, and together you decide what needs to happen. It's not like this a faceless bureaucracy. It's people, person to person, and it's more, you know, rather than the, you know, like Colin talked about this bureaucracy, it's more like the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan stops, other people have walked by. He doesn't say, oh, here's the number of a rehab, or, you know, he puts, you know, he dresses his wounds, he puts them on his donkey, maybe. I don't know if he had a donkey. But he brings him to the inn, he pays the innkeeper, he says, listen, I'll come back. He takes responsibility from the get-go. He is a personalist, you know, and I think that's if Catholic, if we could do more of this, these kind of Catholic Worker type communities, Catholic Worker House of Hospitality attached to parishes, yeah, I think people's hearts would be converted in many different ways. My own heart is converted, but people who are interacting and personally getting involved, and that's what we need, I think, is like a revolution of the heart, as Dorothy Day called it. And I'm going way on and on.
No, I think that's great. The one thing I think, just to add to that, is like that, kind of like Colin said at the beginning, like houses of hospitality were originally sort of this call that Dorothy and Peter made to parishes, right? To say, yeah, okay, you have a rectory that has 5 bedrooms or 6 bedrooms. Like, open up one of those bedrooms for, you know, Christ the Stranger. So I think that's something that any parish can do. And even more importantly, it becomes a space where people know that they can go there for help. So we've had friends, you know, bring, we had one friend, Bling, who came a couple times this fall. He was brought by, you know, he was told by one of our friends, yo, you can go there and like James will help you. And he was in the process of getting evicted, so you're helping him through that. And so I think that's kind of one of those key lessons of the Catholic Worker. If you have a place that is available and open to the public, and I think a lot of churches, people still see them as open and available, but so often they're locked or people haven't been given any of the formation, right, to know how to respond, to know how to like build relationship with someone who's coming in a crisis, to not be afraid of that crisis, which can often be scary or intimidating, but to say, oh, okay, like, cool, I can still find a way to connect with this person no matter what they're going through and just sit with them, have a cup of coffee, hear them out, you know, see if I can do anything, if I can say, you know what, like, just come back tomorrow and let me know how it's going, you know. So I think that's kind of what people can take from that story and think about, okay, how can this work? How can we build that practice of hospitality and availability in our parish?
I think that's the last word. Thanks, all. You guys have anything else you need to get in? Rene, James?
You don't need a house of hospitality. We all have some maybe people here. We would take in people. Dorothy Day, my house growing up, we had refugee families, and I was one of eight, but it is something you can do on your own, have a Christ room in your home. Maybe not for, you know, someone hardcore home, but, you know, a refugee or a friend, etc. That's it.
Thanks, guys.